Hey, my friends, thanks for coming over. Happy 2022. Happy and healthy New Year to everybody. I say healthy, but don't get too close. I'm contagious right now. I'm at home resting up, but my doctor said to keep active. So here we are, active. Before I start, let me just say thanks. I started my channel a year ago. And as of New Year's Eve 2021, I have 406 subscribers. Right on. Thank you. That's exciting. I'm really going to try and make things better as I go along. Maybe more info, a little less chitter chatter. Is that a word? I'm not succeeding right now in doing that, am I? But I'm just excited that you came over. And you're helping me on the bikes today. So what are we doing today? I will be installing these beautiful Core Moto stainless steel braided brake lines, but these are extra schnazzy, and I'll show you why. Cool thing though. So I'm not sponsored or anything by anybody at this point. I found Core Moto online. I really liked the look of their product and how it's put together. It's built here in the good old US of A. There's no of there, but it's implied. They are stainless steel braided. They come in different color sheaths. I got a black sheath. And then look, I'll take it out of package in a sec. I went the extra mile. That is 24 karat gold. Woo! These are for my 2008 Ninja 250 track bike, which has a black and gold thing going. So I figured, why the heck not? I bought these actually a while ago, Black Friday. Up until then, they were about $50 more expensive, but they had an awesome Black Friday sale. Made these with the gold, 24 karat gold fittings, $50 cheaper than normal, which put them in the same price range as their ones that there's like a gold anodized, but it's not 24 karat gold, so it's not quite as much of a rich gold luster. And the other thing with these is the banjo bolts. It also comes with the copper crush washers, but these banjo bolts are also 24 karat gold. Yes, I know, I'm pretty special. The anodized ones are not quite as a rich color, and they don't have anodized gold bolts. They only had 24 karats, so they'll match the banjo fittings a lot better. So this cost me a hundred. Oops, sorry, somebody's contacting me on my cellular telephone. Allow me to quiet that. Did you see my unlocking thing? I'm gonna have to change it now. I like you, but do I trust you? I'm just kidding. Okay, so yeah, these okay, I think they were $132. Normally they'd be $182. The regular non-24 karat gold ones were normally $132. So I figured I would splurge. So here's the other cool thing about these Core Moto, and I will put their link down below in the description. Here's their website, regardless. It's coremoto.com. Pardon the lights. So they sell these. You can get ready-made lengths with the correct fittings for different years, makes, and models of motorcycles. So all I had to do was plug in a 2008 Kawasaki Ninja 250R. Front and rear, and you could buy just the front, just the rear, or a pair, and they're already pre-made to the correct length with the correct direction fittings if there's an angle or if they're straight, for example. Also, they have these rubber bumpers. These will clip into the stock spots on the bike that the stock hoses would have clipped in to keep from chafing. And keep them in place. But here's the cool thing. Because of upgrades I've done to the Ninja, for example, here, let me bring you over to the bike real quick. For those that are unfamiliar with it. For example, I have installed these clip-on handlebars. So the stock bars would be right up around here somewhere, including the master cylinder. That's about a 3-inch difference. So I was able to order the hose for the front with the correct banjo fittings, but I ordered it 2 inches shorter than stock rather than 3. But the point is that you can order under or over the lengths you need. I only did 2 inches because there's a slight chance these are gonna turn into slightly higher clip-ons in the future. So I wanted to leave myself enough wiggle room to have either these or the slightly taller clip-ons. And then in the back here, because you can see in a previous episode, I've installed these rear sets. That brought the rear master cylinder, and the plunger I should say, forward about an inch. So I got the rear brake hose 1 inch longer. So that's another beautiful thing about Core Moto. You can add or subtract lengths that you need. And if you have any questions whatsoever, if you call them up, they are really awesome on the phone. They'll answer all of your questions. Look, these either even come marked. See here it says rear caliper, all right, and then front caliper, right? Or actually that one says right caliper, because some of these have a right and a left. But they're marked for you, and then they also have these real snazzy little, their logo on there. You can pick the color of the outside sheath. You can pick the color of the printing on their little logo thing, and the color of the the color of the printing on that too. And maybe the color of the rubber thingy that it's printed on. With the gold ones, you only had a choice of black and white, but with the anodized ones, you can get any colors you want. So you can make your bike all nice and snazzy. And again, that price included all the fittings I needed. And there's some instructions in here as well. So I've read through these once before. I'm going to look through them again. And I'll point out what they tell you, an important bit of info as we go along. So I will have to get the fluid out of the bike, replace it with some fresh DOT4 fluid. The other thing I'd like to try and do, somebody gave me these. I believe they are the correct front brake pads for the Ninja. My front brake pads need replacing. If these are indeed the correct ones, I will be putting these on. These are sinter pads. And this is all in preparation for 2022 track days with the SMRI Track and Race Club Motorcycle Club here in Albuquerque. I'll give you their link down below too. All right, so that's what we're doing today. Stay tuned. Let me set you up on the tripod and we will start moving forward. Alright, first thing we're going to have to do is take the fluid out of the front master cylinder. Although if I remember correctly, I've already done that. But just to kind of run you through the process, there are a bunch of different ways you can do this. The easiest is take the cover off, get yourself something like this little eyedrop thingy or a turkey baster from the dollar store, and just suck it up and dispose of it in a container. Do not reuse that fluid. Another way you can do it, if you want to spend a little extra money, and you can also use this to break the blue lines, is this MityVac. It is indeed Mighty. You can purchase these at Harbor Freight. I'll put a link for it below. You can get them other places online as well. Here's basically what it looks like. It's a hand pump with a pressure gauge on there. It comes with a variety, a couple of hoses, a catch can container with the one cover on it like this, that you can have one hose running to the pump and one running to your fittings. Then it's got a cover too, so after it's full you can cover it, I guess, and get rid of the stuff without it spilling. And then you have a variety of different fittings, some tapered ones. These are for the bleeder valves on calipers, a couple different sizes of those, like a suction cup thingy, yada yada. Now what is all this stuff? Why? So besides just using this for bleeding brakes like most people I know do, you can also do various tests for vacuum lines, let's say, on cars and such. The service manual or the user's manual here will explain all of that to you. But we're going to use this to bleed our brakes and empty the master cylinder just because I have it. You know what I mean? All right, let me set you up and we'll take care of that. All right, let's get started. There are a couple of things you're definitely going to want to do before you get started. Absorbent paper towels and or rags. You will spill stuff. You don't want brake fluid all over the place. This is .4 brake fluid. .3 is pretty dang corrosive. You don't want to get it on your paint or anything. You also don't want it on your brake pads, on your rotors, etc. So just always be ready to mop up your spills right away. The other thing you might want, it's not mandatory, but it's definitely recommended. These are JIS, Japanese Industrial Standard bits. They look like Phillips, but they are not. There's a different angle and what have you. The screws on Japanese motorcycles are Japanese industrial standard, so especially for smaller screws like that, if you notice they get chewed up with your Phillips screwdriver, it's because they're not Phillips, right? And especially if you do older bikes like I do, much older than this even, JIS bits help. I bought a set of 3 bits from eBay. It's just the bit. And then I bought this magnetic handle with the storage in the handle. The bits and the handle together, 20 something bucks. Or you can buy just the 3 main sizes of JIS screwdrivers. But a good set's going to run you $60 and up. So this was a low cost alternative to have high quality bits and a handle. Alright, so the first thing I'm going to do here is just kind of turn the handlebars. You can't see the master cylinder now. I'll move you because of that. But you want it to be sitting level, right? Because when it's out here, it's at an angle. Now where it's sitting there, it's parallel to the ground. So when I open that, it's not going to spill all over the place. All right, so those are loose. I want to grab my rag. And finish taking those out. Before you heard me go, the magnetic bits, they'll pick up every shred of like little bit of metal that you've ground, sanded, etc. So you got to be careful. You got to clean them. Good way to clean them is with if you have an air compressor and an air fitting on the end, you just blow them and it pushes all the debris off. But you don't want that getting in here. All right, so those are loose. Covers off. A little bit of fluid under there. Like I said, I think I may have done this already. And then here's the diaphragm. You do not want to tear that, get it dirty or anything. And then there's a, I don't know what you'd call it, spacer maybe, that fits inside of that. It helps it keep its shape from collapsing too when it's creating a suction or a vacuum. Yeah, so what we're doing here pertains to just about every motorcycle. It doesn't have to be for a Ninja 250. But that's that. So I'm going to put that on the side, keeping it clean. I don't want it. Anything that happened to that, you definitely don't want to tear that diaphragm either. And then can you see, oh, I just kicked you. You okay? It's empty. I already emptied it before, so I just wanted to make sure. Okay, so that can stay empty. I'm just gonna pop the cover on top of it loosely just to keep any debris from possibly getting in there. Actually, I'm gonna pop the diaphragm with its spacer thingy because that's the better fit, just to keep anything from blowing in there by mistake. All right, now let's set you up at the caliper end. All right, so first things first, this bike has a safety wire on it. So I just need to clip that, take it off. This was previously used from the previous owner as a race bike, which it's required to safety wire stuff. I may eventually do this to my KZ750. If I do, I'll make a video about how to do that. For now, I'm just taking the old safety wire off. And when you clip this stuff, throw it right in the trash. Don't let it sit on your garage floor because you'll forget about it and it will get in your tires and it will mess them up. Okay, so I got that off just in preparation. What we're gonna do now is, this is the bleeder right there, and it's got this little rubber cap on it. That's to help prevent debris getting in there when you're done doing what we're doing. I'm gonna remove it for now. It's just elastic. You just kind of pull it out of the way. So now I'm gonna take the this is the speed bleeder, the MityVac thing, right? It's biggest pain in the butt with these is these stupid rubber hoses. Like, you want it long enough to always be able to do the jobs you need to do, but they have a memory and it just, like, your thing falls and, oh, I hate it. But it is what it is. So I'm taking this particular fitting. It's a rubber fitting that will clip right onto there, mainly with pressure. Okay, what I'm trying now to do is I just want to get the fluid out of this line so that when we undo the line, it doesn't all just pour out right on the floor. So that's on. Now, if you see that gauge, I'm going to start pumping this and I'm building pressure. Now, you don't want to overdo it because you can blow the seals in here. All right, so I'm going to, what am I here? 10, right? And that should be fine. And I can just take this out of my hand, just sit on the floor. I'm trying to keep, you can't see it, but this container is sitting on the ground there, right? And then once I loosen this, you will see this, the pressure on the gauge here going down, and it's sucking the fluid out. So let's see if, I just lost pressure. That's because this thing moved. Okay, there we go again. Let's try that again. All right, and it's going down. And I don't know if you could hear the fluid coming out. I'm going to tighten that up a little bit. Do it again. Pumping it back up. Now let's get you right there. And then loosen that up. More fluid came out just a little bit. Tighten it back up. And I'll do it one more time for good measure. When you tighten this bleeder valve here, you don't have to kill it. Just snug. All right, pump that up again. See it going up? Okay, you've seen that move. Let's see if any more fluid comes out. I'll bring it closer. Look over here. Little bit. You see that fluid coming out there? All right. So now I'm going to just start pumping this handle. Sorry, it's really hard to get you in the right position while I'm doing that. But I think most of the fluid is out of that line. I'm okay with that. I'm gonna take that off too. If there is any more fluid left in the line, just gravity too, that's another way to get this fluid out. It's just gravity. You can just put a hose on there, have the other end of the hose into some kind of container, an empty jar or something, and you just crack that open. And gravity, it takes time, but will force that fluid out. Just make sure the container is below the height of the caliper. There's fluid inside these cavities. There are two pistons in here. Basically, when you when there's fluid in the line and it's all bled, when you press the brake lever, there's a piston inside the master cylinder that pushes that way, that pushes fluid down the brake line, and that fluid is here, that pushes out, and the two pistons in here push, and that's what helps compress your brake pads. And then when you let go of the lever, the fluid goes back up out of here, the pressure releases, pushes it back out and back up the line into the master cylinder, and it releases the pressure. That's basically how it works. There's a little more to it than that, but that's the basic idea. All right, there's nothing coming out of here, so I'm just gonna snug this. For people that cringe because I'm not using the box end, it's okay. You'll live. Look, ooh, yay. But this gets in the way sometimes, so. All right, now, next step, and for this I do want to have my rags and stuff handy. I'm gonna crack open the banjo bolts on both sides, and some fluid may still come out of here, but I need to remove it from the bike, all right? So I'll set you up for that. The other thing I'm gonna do first, this fitting holds this rubber piece right here, which holds the line in place. Remember those rubber pieces I showed you on the Core Moto lines? That's where one of them goes, okay? And also, like, this fitting has a slight bend, and then this fitting, I don't know if you can see, is more straighter. So you gotta make sure that you put the correct side of the Core Moto lines, the new lines, where they go. All right, so let me put you down. Let me get my tools and we'll keep going. All right, so first things first, loosening this bolt here. I'm being careful not to smash into the fork leg because you don't want to ding that. Right. Go, take that out. That's a 10 millimeter, by the way. Now that frees that up, and then I'll pry this little clip thing off of here and reuse it for the new lines. Next, let's get you down here. Okay, here we go. That, I believe, is a 12 millimeter. I am correct. And my rag, which is completely out of reach. Actually, the first thing I want to do is take the one out from here. Can you peek under there? Right there? You cannot. Let's see, right there. I want to take out the banjo bolt from the master cylinder. Nothing to it, I'm just loosening it and taking the bolt out, grabbing my rag, minimize any spillage. All right. no spillage. And now let's do the same thing down here. My battery's about to die, but I think we'll be okay. Ooh, that's crusty. I'm glad this is coming out. And mind you too, on either side of your banjo bolt or crush washer. So you have your bolt, where are you? A crush washer, your banjo fitting, another crush washer. You want to replace those? Okay, so that's off. I'm just going to feed that out of there. And I'm going to keep it there just so it shows me how to run the new line. Because I'm getting old and I forget. Right? All right, let me swap batteries and bring it back. All right, here's where we're at. Just looking over the instruction manual. They want you to verify because different brake calipers have different thread pitches. Now this says 1.25, which is what I believe these are, the stock ones, but I'm gonna take these out of the package one-handed. How impressive is that? I may use my teeth. I used my teeth. Don't hold it against me. And if you see, we get four banjo bolts in stunning 24 karat gold. Yeah, I splurged. And then you have two crush washers per bolt, right? Now, let's see. Here's a quick and easy way to see if your stuff is the same pitch. You hold the threads up against each other, and they should lock right into place, which they do. And that tells you that they are the same thread pitch. The length is different, but that's okay. The diameter is important. They're the same diameter. Now here was the other thing I needed to refresh my memory in the instructions here. So these, when I first took these out of the package, I noticed that when you ran the line through the bike, the banjo fittings did not face in the correct direction. And that's a problem because these are steel, right? There's a steel braided line under here. Now this happens to have a black coating over it, but the problem is there's not much flex to these, so you can't just twist the line, nor do you want to get it to fit. So I wasn't sure what you do, but here they tell you, you take the hose, you wrap it around your hand a couple times just to steady it with just the end of the banjo fitting sticking out, and then you want to take a pen or a pencil or something similar, and you can start twisting and rotating these. Now, it sounds easy. It might be a little snug. We'll see. The other thing is you do not want to do that with like a metal punch or something. You do not want to gouge the internals of this fitting. So you do want to use a rubber-coated pen or something. It's got to be sturdy enough, but not something that's going to mar the finish. Okay, so let me put you back on the tripod. We're gonna run this line by hand through the bike and just kind of temporarily fit it to the master cylinder, bring it down to the caliper, and then see. Actually, I'm gonna attach to the caliper first because that's the one with the odd shaped fitting. Run it up and then see how much, if at all, we have to turn that banjo bolt, and then we'll take care of that. So hang tight. Okay, so before I screw anything into anywhere, I just wanna, there's a little bit of schmutz, dirt, debris, just from old bikes and people's, other than me owning this, I just wanna clean that all out. So there's I'm seeing a lot of debris in there. So let's use this MityVac in one of its functions, right? Hang on, let me get the fittings. So yeah, I see a lot of debris in there. So I dug through the fittings and there's this conical shaped one with a large hole. There are a lot with smaller holes too. It does fit in there just fine. I want to suck out as much of the crap as I see in there. So I'm going to remove this banjo fitting and pop on this, right? And then you can't actually see in the caliper, but you can see what I'm doing to the caliper in the bleed hole. Let's straighten you up. Excuse the noise, my furnace just kicked in. So right there, I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna stick that in the hole and just start pumping. And maybe you can see how it's pulling out all of that old fluid and debris. So I'm using it like a vacuum cleaner, right? Because why have all that crap floating around your fresh brake lines? You don't want that. When I put it here, it actually is creating some vacuum, which is good. All right, you see what I'm saying? So these MityVacs come in handy for a lot of things. Now, I am gonna take a Q-tip, brand name, not sponsored, and just kind of clean this up. And the reason I don't want to put the new brake pads in first is in case there's any spillage, whatever, I minimize fouling my new brake pads, right? So there's just some crap in the threads I'm getting out. Be careful with Q-tips, they can leave fibers behind. So that is something to be aware of. All right, so that's that. Good. Let me back you back out. So we have a minimum of spillage and what have you, which is good. Now let me go get the hoses. So I'm going to use the one of the original banjo bolts for the moment, because I don't want to crank down on the new ones. I'm still using one of the old crush washers. There's one on there already, sliding that through. And then the other crush washer, but I'm not going to put any fluid, so it doesn't matter if they seal or not. Oops. So, see, here's something important. See how this has a bend like that? Now I'm going to try and do that, and that's fine. It just will fight you a little bit. So keep that in mind. You could try and move the fittings so you don't have that bend. You can have it in the other direction. Up to you. Doesn't really matter that much. And now I'm just gonna put this in place carefully. Don't wanna mar anything. Don't wanna. Oh, I went the wrong way. Please excuse me. Pardon me. Spasmodicon. All right. There we go. There you go. All right. And I'm trying to be careful. I don't want to mar my snazzy gold fittings. All right. And then that. And then that. It doesn't have to be. I want it tight so it's not bouncing around, but I'm not torquing it down. Just kind of getting it on there. All right, so that took its general position. That's going to be up there. It doesn't really matter. But here's the part I want us to pay attention to. Let me get you up here. There we go. So here's where the line comes out, and right now this fitting is not facing in the correct direction to mount it into the face of the master cylinder right there. See, it's about 90 degrees out. So I'm gonna have to turn this 90 degrees so it lines up with the hole, because you do not want to just turn and put the pressure on the entire line. I just dropped my diaphragm. I'd like to blame that I'm sick on me doing stupid things today. Sure, that's the ticket. Anyway, you see what I'm saying? So let's take that out. I'll leave the other end attached to the caliper. And let's try to turn it 90 degrees and get it where it needs to be, so it's facing the right direction. The first thing I'd like to do is I'm going to take a grease pencil and just mark where I want it to face, just so I have an indicator. All right. Then, and it doesn't matter which side of this, oh, where are you? It doesn't matter which side of this faces that way. They're both the same. Let me go get my pen. Okay, I found this old Bic pen of mine. And then we're gonna do that. Hold it tightly. Can you see? I sure hope so, because I can't see what you're seeing while I'm doing this. Now I'm sticking the pen in. It says you may need to rotate back and forth a few times. Take your time. Oh, that was super easy. Super much easier than I imagined. That's nice. That makes it simple. So now let's go back through here. See, I left the old one in because I totally forgot. Did it go that way or through the front and the back? So that's a nice thing. And now, let's see, does it line up? Where are you at? There you at. Now, look at that. Lines right up. Can you see that? That's so handy, right? So that's the trick, right? Right, so now we can go ahead and actually put the proper banjo fittings on and tighten everything down. Let me go get all that ready and we'll do that together. Okay, so that's clean. We've got our banjo bolts. Now, one thing I've done, this is a 14 millimeter bolt, right? I took a little bit of painter's tape and I've wrapped it around the edges because I don't want to mar my schnazzy gold finish. And that's one way to try and eliminate that. I think they sell sockets that are soft on the inside too, but that's one way to do it. And then I've got my new crush washers. These are copper, sometimes they're aluminum. You have to pay attention. There's a flat side and there's a crowned side. It's hard for you to see that, I think, in the camera. Crowned side, flat side. I want the flat sides to touch like this. So crown up and down, flat side against the banjo fitting. That should guarantee that I have a nice solid seal. So crown side down or up against the head, is that too confusing? And then flat side towards the fitting, right? And then flat side towards the fitting and crown side down towards the caliper. And then I will start tightening that by hand. If it doesn't go in easily, don't force it. There's a problem. So that's going in by hand. That's really good. Okay. And then there's a cutout here in the caliper that the banjo fitting fits into, and that's to keep it from turning when you're tightening it down. So here's my 14 millimeter. It'll be snug, but it'll go on there. And there's a torque value for that, but you just basically want it snug. All right, and that's good. I'm gonna leave the tape on there for when we bleed it after. If there's any leaking, I can snug it up again without having to tape it. The next thing I want to do, if you remember, on our stock line is that little bracket brace thingy. I'm just bending it open by hand, pulling it off, and then taking this and putting it on here, tightening it back up by hand. Oh, you didn't see any of that. I'm sorry. Here, let me redo it. I'm taking it back out. All right, so here's the thing I just unbent by hand. There's the rubber part. Putting it back on and then bending it again by hand, right? Now, what's going on? That's supposed to fit there, but I feel like, maybe I have to put it on the other direction. I don't remember. That's why taking pictures is important. I just did this like 10 minutes ago. You'd think it would be in my brain, but it's not. Did it go like that? I seem to remember it being on in the other direction. I'm gonna play with that some more, like that. I don't want to do it too much, but no. All right, let me look at my photographs, and man, my brain. They say there's brain fog when you're sick. All right, thanks for your patience. My brain is foggy, so it's this way, and then the bulb to the back, the hump. I was close. I'm just not feeling that good. So let's put that on by blocking a little bit. Just a little bit. I'm in a weird position so that you can see. Alright. Tighten that down. And there should still be play in here, because this is a little taut right now for my tastes. Taut for my tastes. Right here. So we'll be able to play with that. I just want to snag it up just a little bit. Just enough to have it not wiggle. And then we can play with the length. All right, now let's go up to the master cylinder. All right, we're at the master cylinder now. Same thing, I've taped up the end of the fitting and then the two crush washers. I've got one on there already. Reminder, the flat sides touch the banjo fitting. So that's going to slide on. That's going to slide on. I've already cleaned out the threads in here and any gunk that was in there. And by hand, carefully tighten that up. Oops, did I bump you? I'm sure. Let's bring it over here so you can see exactly what I'm doing. Now, this is going backwards. I may leave it that way. I may move it just a little. Let's just kind of snug it up for the moment. All right, now let's bring it to the front side. Let's see what we've got going on. So, might be better if I take you off. So you see here, that's on, right? But then you got it coming down here. There's a big loop and then another loop. So I'm gonna pull down on that because my forks are gonna compress up and down, right? You can use that little bit of extra there, and I'd kind of rather have it there down here than up top here, because there is the possibility of it binding when you turn the wheel, although I will check for that. But now what I did here too, this was back like that. I've pushed it forward. It seems to kind of naturally want to sit there, and it's sitting behind the throttle cables, right? So that's not a bad place for it. Maybe just somewhere in between. So it's not touching these, right? And you, that's part of this. Like, you just kind of have to play with it. So you see now it's not touching. It was all the way up front. It was all the way in the back. Why don't we kind of split the difference, airing to the front? Does that make sense? Okay, I'm going to snug that down. I need both hands, so I'll shut you off for the moment, and then we'll see what we've got. Alright, so now we're getting ready to bleed the brakes. I was going to change the front brake pads first, but it ends up the brake pads I have are not the right ones. So there's no need to wait. We can bleed the brakes now, take care of that, and then when I get the brake pads in, we'll put those in. So first things first, this is a DOT-4 brake system. If you look on here, this is a DOT-4 brake fluid. Now, there can be some confusion between DOT-3, 4, 5, 5.1. I'm just going to talk about DOT-3 and DOT-4 at the moment. Basically, they are interchangeable. You can mix a DOT-4 with a DOT-3. If you have DOT-3 in your system, well, let me backtrack. The difference being, DOT-4 has a higher temp boiling point. So this is a 475 degree boiling point. DOT-3 has a lower boiling point. So basically, if you're using your brakes a lot, what you do when you're racing, you want a higher boiling point so that you're not boiling the brake fluid, getting brake fade, etc. And that's the whole reason you might use DOT-4 rather than DOT-3. But let's say you had DOT-3 in your system and you were low and you only had some DOT-4 laying around, you can absolutely pour this into your DOT-3. Typically, you won't do the opposite. Like if you have a DOT-4 system and you're low, you might not put DOT-3 in, not because they're not compatible, but because the DOT-3 has a lower boiling point, you're basically lowering the overall boiling point of your fluid now if you're adding the DOT-3 to the DOT-4. But in a pinch, you can totally do it. Or for example, on my KZ750 twin that I'm gonna race this year, it's a DOT-3 setup right now. I'm just gonna drain the DOT-3 out, but I don't have to do anything special as far as completely flushing the lines. I can just get the bulk of it out, and I plan on replacing it with DOT-4. All right, so now we're gonna fill this master cylinder. It can be messy, so you need to be careful. Just gonna take our cover off, make sure there's no dirt, debris, or otherwise. And for the moment, I'm just gonna fill it up to not quite the top. I just don't want it to spill over. when you open up your bottle of fluid, you always want to make sure the top is clean. You don't want any debris getting in your system. All right, and that's it. That's good for now. Now, keep in mind, there are a lot of ways to bleed a brake system. I'm going to use that MityVac, so I'm going to do that today. But if you didn't have a MityVac, you can use the gravity method I mentioned earlier, where you just unscrew the bleed screw on the caliper just enough to let this fluid feed through. But you'd have to pull the lever in to do that, because when you pull the lever in, that's what allows fluid to travel down the line. Or another way is you can pull in and release, pull in and release, and you'll see little bubbles coming out of your master cylinder. That means you're priming the line, because remember, our brake line is empty. That can take a while, but that's how you do that. And you always have to make sure you don't empty the master cylinder when you're doing that, right? I know I'm explaining it and not showing it, so please forgive that, but I am going to use the MityVac, and let's do that and see how much easier it is to do it that way. All right, we're ready to start bleeding the brakes. I'm going to mostly be showing you what's going on down here. Just keep in mind that every time we pump up the MityVac and then we crack open the bleeder screw, it's sucking fluid from the master cylinder. So every time we do that, because we have to get the entire brake line full, we also have to get the cavity inside of the caliper full, because we sucked that dry when we cleaned it out. That's a lot of fluid. So it's going to be drawing the fluid from where? The master cylinder. So every time we suck the fluid in, we tighten that, the bleeder, we check the amount of fluid inside the master cylinder, and when it gets low, we top it off again. You don't want to just start sucking air through that again, because then you're defeating the purpose. What we're attempting to do right now is get all of the air out of the brake lines. Okay, that's what we're trying to do. Okay, so let me bring you down here so you can see the vac, which is mighty. And let's get to work. Master cylinder is full. I'm gonna pump up the MityVac, get pressure, and I'm gonna crack this open. And when I do that, I'll be looking up top at the master cylinder to see how much fluid is getting sucked out. And when it gets a little too low, I'll tighten the bleeder. There it goes, it's going down, about halfway, about a quarter, and then tighten. Okay, so let's top this off again. Careful not to spill any. There we go, it's topped off. And then repeat, repeat, repeat. All right, so here's where we're at. I've been pumping this, like you've seen, draining a lot of fluid through the system. So I'm doing that to kind of prime everything. Now, I have fluid back in the master cylinder, and I have the diaphragm and cap on there. And now we're going to bleed this like you would normally bleed brakes while using the MityVac. So I'm going to pump up the MityVac, build some pressure. Okay, I'm gonna pull in the brake lever a few times and then hold it down and then just crack this open till the brake lever comes to the handlebars and then close the bleeder. Okay, and then close it. And then let go of the handle. Make sure I still have enough fluid. I do. Pump that up a few times. Now we're pumping air with the brake lever through the system and making sure that it's engaging well and getting rid of any air pockets inside the line. So I'm pumping that up, holding the lever down, cracking open the bleeder till the lever touches the handlebar, lock the bleeder, let go of the brake lever, and pump. So I can already feel the brake lever getting stiffer. And then it loosens up again because it finds air. And then again, always checking that there's enough fluid in there. There's enough for one or two more tries like that. So let's do that. There's still pressure in my MityVac. That's why I'm not pumping that up more. So brake lever a few times, hold the brake lever in, crack the bleeder, let the brake lever come to the handlebars, lock the bleeder, let go, and start pumping that up. So we're just gonna repeat that over and over again until the brakes completely firm up. We're almost there. I can feel it. I'm gonna top off the master cylinder and just keep doing that. And we should be good. Best laid plans, right? Here's where we're at. After much bleeding, I just couldn't get the front brakes to firm up. And I was giving them a really nice tight squeeze, and poof, something let go. There's nothing pouring out. There's no way that I blew the steel braided line or anything like that. I'm 99.99999% certain of that. There's nothing pouring out of the caliper. I'm suspecting the seals inside here, the master cylinder piston. So I want to take this apart and see. As you can see, the dust shield on here was already pretty chewed up. That's just the dust shield though. It's not gonna hurt or keep fluid back or anything like that. But I'm suspecting it. I want to take it apart. You can get a rebuild kit for about 15 or 20 bucks. So let me take this apart. I'll show you what it looks like inside. And we'll go from there. There's not much else that could happen. I mean, it could leak from here. Now I notice there's a crack in the glass right there. That could do it. Indeed. Yeah, because also when I was squeezing the lever, I'd hear a little bit of air getting sucked in. This piece of glass, I believe is, I don't know if it's part of, it pops out. It may be part of the seal here, but that would let air in. And I can blow air through it. All right, let's take this apart and see. I actually bought a new one of these dust shields. So, if the rings in there are fine, it's probably this. All right, let me check. Hang on. All right, so I grabbed, these are snap ring pliers, but they're made for master cylinders. Why? Because there's a snap ring inside there. Not sure, can you see it? But it's deep in, right? And regular snap ring pliers usually don't reach that far. So these are made for master cylinders. Now I've made my own tools before that were able to get it out, but this makes it so much easier. This one's Motion Pro, I think. Yeah. Here's the part number, MP for Motion Pro, 08-0279. I'll put the link for that down below. Now when you pull this out, just take it in order. So here's what you've got. Let me clean that up a bit. I'm going to change my glasses too because my other work glasses, oh look at that. Have I've shown this in a different video. These are a new pair, but you see how these have bifocals? It's not for looking far and looking close. I don't need glasses to look far, especially doing this kind of work. You can't work on anything that's not within hand's reach, right? So the larger part of the lens is for looking close, about where you would read a book, And then the bifocal, the lower part, is for even closer, so I can get my face right up into stuff. So this spring sits inside there, right, like that. When you push on the brake lever, it pushes on that, which depresses the spring. But then, see how this washer in here is kind of like a top hat? That pushes fluid from in here, right, like that. It pushes the fluid to go through the line into your brake lever, and then this other one here will seal. One's a push hole and one's a return hole. The other one will seal the return hole, and then when you let go of the lever, it goes back and the return hole opens and you get fluid back in. Sometimes you may pull in a brake line, brake lever on an older bike especially, and then it just stays in place. Sometimes that's because this return hole is plugged up. But if you look closely, I don't know if you can see, this, it's chewed right there. It's all chewed up. So that's no good. That needs replacing. This one's not so bad. But usually when you buy the kit, like you buy the whole thing. So yeah, that's bad. I could never get these brakes even before I swapped these brake lines out. And now I know why. And then you've got this here. I'm not going to pop that out until I see that it's available and I can buy it and that it's not $5,000. What this is your fill sight glass. It's usually similar to, if there's a sight glass, there's not on this bike, but on some other bikes, this sight glass is sometimes the same as the one on the oil case. But basically that's where you look to see if you have enough fluid. But because that's cracked, that's got to be airtight, and it's definitely not, and that explains a lot. Well, so I'm not going to pop that out yet. I'm going to jump on eBay and look around and see if I can find that part. For anyone that doesn't know, I don't know if other brands do this, but for Kawasaki, if you go to kawasaki.com, I have trouble doing this on my telephone, so do it on a laptop or a desktop or a tablet. Go to kawasaki.com. Then you click on owners, owners section, something like that, and then on parts, and then you can choose motorcycle, then the year and the model, and you get all the parts diagrams and the parts numbers. So if you're ever looking for parts and you can't find them just by typing in, let's say, master cylinder sight glass, you can type in Kawasaki and then the part number you got off kawasaki.com. Type that into the eBay search bar, just Google search bar, and see where you can find those parts. All right? Okay, folks, let's fix that. No wonder. I could have died. That would suck. So I went on eBay and I ordered a rebuild kit, which is going to include this piston, these two top hat type of washers, O-ring seals, the spring, and also this dust shield. And I also ordered a pack of four of these side glass windows. Altogether, it was like $22 for everything, including tax. Once we get those are your universal fit thing. They didn't have an exact part number for this, even on the Kawasaki site, so I just had to buy something that would fit. I am curious to see, I think that's acrylic. I'm wondering if I could put heat to that and kind of seal it. I'm just curious as an experiment. But like I said, it's a four pack, so we can play around a little bit without worrying about messing it up. Alright, so that's going to take a little while to get here. So I decided I'm going to break this into two videos. It went from just installing the Core Moto brake lines and bleeding them to now having to rebuild this master cylinder. So this will end part one. Please let me know if you have any questions, comments, concerns. If you enjoyed any part of this video, please like and subscribe. Let's see how many of you have something to say, have any questions, etc. All right, hang tight until then. Have a good one. Talk to you soon. Thanks for hanging out. Appreciate it. And be well. Take care for now.